This is Valley View News.
Anti-American protest at Afghanistan's U.S. embassy in Kabul injured 15 police officers. A new bill would allow for home chefs in California to make and sell food from their homes. Some experts say more than half of America's dogs are fat. A gym membership for pooches may be the solution.
Welcome to Valley View News. I'm Dennis Aru.
And I'm Emily Davies. Today marks the anniversary of the Occupy Wall Street movement. Last fall, hundreds of protesters marched on the nation's financial center and kicked off a nationwide social movement. Organizers are commemorating the day with a bike ride in Manhattan, a People's Wall picket line at the New York Stock Exchange, and a concert featuring Tom Morello of Rage Against the Machine. Organizers say the gathering has evolved from Occupy Wall Street to an Occupy Main Street movement. The focus is now on debtors' revolt, a push to get the money out of politics, and a call for a reformed healthcare system.
NASA's space shuttle Endeavour has faced delays in its journey to Los Angeles, but was expected to arrive as scheduled. Endeavour will be put on display as a permanent exhibit at the Science Center in Exposition Park. It was set to travel on Monday from Florida to Houston, but the trip was pushed back a day because of stormy weather. The craft was set to arrive in LA on Thursday. The public can watch a $2 billion spacecraft travel the streets on its way to Exposition Park. The shuttle will be on display at the Science Center starting October 30th.
Operating a bakery out of a home kitchen is illegal in California, but that could change. Maribel Serrano tells us more about the story.
The California Homemade Food Act would let people go into business selling food right out of their kitchens. I went out to find out more about what this means for home bakers and property managers.
California bakers have to use a commercial kitchen like this one if they plan on selling their products. While some bakers get paid hourly to work here, others are hopeful that they can start their own business by using their own home kitchen. Baked food like bread is easy to sell. It's not hazardous because it does not easily grow bacteria.
If Bill AB 1616 passes, it will allow for the sale of homemade foods that are considered non-hazardous, such as breads, cookies, nuts, and fruit preserves.
Other foods that people will be able to sell include vinegar, granola, herb blends, and maybe even homemade soda. Rose Lawrence, owner at Red Red, makes a homemade natural fruit syrup, which can be combined with sparkling water for a natural version of soda. She believes that allowing people to grow, bake, and sell their products from home will be a healthy choice.
Right now, most of the food in the nation and in California comes from very processed areas. So I think that it would be exciting both for the economy and for the people who are looking to get better food to see AB 1616 play out.
However, some property managers are concerned with troubles that a home-run cooking business may cause.
If, let's say, they constantly deliver goods, they pick it up, you know, that creates a traffic in residential area. Of course, the smells, they penetrate other people's apartments. There could be diabetic people that would be smelling vanilla and sugar all day long.
If the bill passes, food preparers will still have to apply and be approved for a food handling permit. They will also have to undergo an annual inspection by a local health officer. The food will have to be labeled as homemade and include a list of ingredients. From Los Angeles, this is Maribel Serrano for Valley View News.
If the bill is signed by the governor, there will be a limit on how much money a home chef can earn each year. The cap will be $35,000 next year and go up to $50,000 in 2015. Now back to you in the studio.
Pope Benedict XVI visited Lebanon to call for Christians and Muslims to unite against war. A day after condemning arms trafficking to Syria, the pontiff praised the young Syrians in attendance for their courage. Battles continue to rage in Syria 18 months after the rebellion began. The UN peace envoy conceded that the situation there was deteriorating. The Pope's arrival in Lebanon last Friday coincided with protests that broke out in several Arab nations over the US-made internet video that ridiculed the Prophet Muhammad. Still, his presence in Lebanon was warmly embraced by all the religious factions in attendance.
Libyan authorities have arrested 50 people in connection with the deadly attacks on the U.S. mission in Benghazi. The Libyan protest that killed U.S. Ambassador Chris Stevens and three other Americans appears to have begun spontaneously, but was hijacked by extremists. United Nations Ambassador Susan Rice says the protest began as a response to a video criticizing Islam. The demonstration was then taken over by extremists. Libya's head of the General National Congress says intercepted communications link al-Qaeda to the attack.
Afghan demonstrators attacked police officers near the U.S. Embassy in Kabul on Monday as tensions remained high over the movie criticizing Islam. More than a dozen police officers were injured and two police vehicles burned when nearly 300 Afghans clashed with authorities a few miles from the embassy. The violence is the latest in a string of protests that have spread to more than 20 nations across the Middle East, Asia, and North Africa. The U.S. has increased security at embassies worldwide after last week's deadly attack on the U.S. diplomatic mission in Libya. The protest was sparked by a low-budget movie trailer posted on YouTube that criticized Islam.
Southern California Muslims are honoring victims who were killed at the U.S. embassy in Libya. The attack was sparked by a 15-minute anti-Islamic film. The attack killed 14 people, including four Americans. Muslims say the video is insulting and depicts the Prophet Muhammad as a child molester and a thug. Southern California Muslims say the vigil is meant to tell people that the violence in Benghazi is not supported by the world's Muslims.
Food trucks are going to have to make room on the streets for some new mobile businesses pulling up to the park. Reporter Christina Mofatino has more on the story.
The last Thursday of every month, these mobile boutiques get together in a private lot on Hope Street downtown for a sample sale. Shop Truck LA, Rolling Threads, Le Fashion Truck, and JD Lux are four of LA's mobile boutiques that have been hitting the city streets. The trend is also a practical option for up-and-coming business owners and designers looking to get a start in the retail world. JD Lux is a mobile boutique that sells unique clothing lines by designers and the owners. Co-owner Tyler Kenny says the truck is a way to run a business without having to worry about the cost of rent.
You're not going to have too much overhead. You're not going to pay the monthly fees to own a store. And it's going to be a different kind of shopping experience.
These utility trucks are transformed to where customers can walk up these wooden steps into a fully stocked store. Mobile boutique owner Alejandra Ayala says her husband helped create the truck for a unique shopping experience.
So he came up with the idea of doing this, and he bought me a truck, and he transformed it into a store. We have hardwood floors, we have a TV, a dressing room. So it's like an experience of just shopping in a regular brick and mortar, except we get to travel to different areas.
Alejandra and her husband were looking into renting a store prior to purchasing the truck. They found keeping a store running in an upscale area such as Manhattan Beach can cost up to $4,000 a month. She says the mobile boutique offered them a way to reach different customers without paying the high overhead costs.
I've always wanted to have a store in a location like that, so with those thoughts, he said, well, you know what, we can transform a truck where you're going to be able to travel. So if you want to go to Manhattan Beach, you want to go to the Valley or LA, you're going to be able to go to different places. So instead of us waiting for somebody to come to the store, we're going out to the customers.
The mobile boutique also faces some challenges, one not having regular store hours and locations. The mobile shops use social sites like Facebook, Instagram, and most importantly, Twitter, to let shoppers know their whereabouts. The biggest issue they face is where to park. Since they are around 4 feet longer than your average food truck, mobile boutiques are limited to parking on private property. The cost for a mobile store with inventory is about $12,000. With the attainable business plan, it's no wonder these stores on wheels are starting up in cities like New York, Boston, Portland, and Oregon. In Los Angeles, I'm Christina Mofatino for Valley View News.
Republican presidential nominee Mitt Romney will address the United States Hispanic Chamber of Commerce in Los Angeles. The GOP candidate's attempt to rally the Hispanic vote is expected to face some resistance because of his immigration stance. Members of DREAM, which support undocumented workers, have planned a march following Romney's appearance. Meanwhile, President Obama is making a campaign stop in Ohio. The president will launch a new trade enforcement case against China, targeting Chinese subsidies for exports of automobiles and vehicle parts.
Chicago officials have filed suit asking a judge to force striking teachers to return to work. The action came after the Chicago Teachers Union decided not to vote on a proposal negotiated between union leaders and city officials. The school district says the current strike is illegal under state law. It also argues that the strike denies critical services like meals for low-income children and a safe environment. Mayor Rahm Emanuel said the strike is wrong for the children of Chicago and vowed to force the teachers back to work. The union accused the mayor of bullying and say they need more time to study their proposal. The strike has caused a high demand for child care services as parents struggle to accommodate their schedules.
Thousands of Chinese attacked and damaged Japanese businesses in Beijing. They're angry that Japanese plans to buy several uninhabited islands near Taiwan. Authorities say protesters marched and burned Japanese flags in front of the diplomatic compounds. They say most of the damage was to Japanese restaurants. This is the second day of the violence.
Coming up,
We'll tell you how the new X Factor judges did in their season premiere.
Welcome to my block party. Glad you can make it.
The only triple doubles you get come with fries.
Last time you blocked someone, you were online.
I can do this all day. Your moves are just gay.
Using gay to mean dumb or stupid, not cool.
Not cool.
Not in my house, not anywhere. It's not creative, it's offensive to gay people. And you're better than that.
I help you find a home.
I help you find a home.
Hey, maybe you'll be picked next.
Maybe you'll be picked next.
We've been caged together too long.
We've been caged together too long.
How come nobody ever picks me?
Maybe they're looking for somebody different.
Pick me.
Well, the shelter's closing up for another day. We didn't get picked.
I know.
Tomorrow. Guaranteed.
We got the spirit. We're hot. We can't be stopped. We got the spirit. We're hot. We can't be stopped. We're going to beat them and bust them.
The smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life.
Let's get a little bit rowdy. R-O-W-D-Y.
Take time to be a dad today. Call or visit fatherhood.gov to learn more.
So, same time next week?
Well, of course.
Put away a few bucks, feel like a million bucks. For free tips to help you save, go to
Feed the Pig.
Actress Angelina Jolie is visiting the Kurdistan region of Iraq in her latest trip to the Middle East. Jolie met with Kurdish officials when she arrived before visiting a Syrian refugee camp. She met with other Iraqi officials and discussed government efforts to help refugees. Authorities say there are as many as 21,000 refugees in Iraq. Jolie has recently visited camps in Turkey, Jordan, and Lebanon to highlight the need for international humanitarian assistance.
A Hollywood celebrity artist has made his dream come true. Valley View News reporter Rigo Villalobos has the story.
Robert Delgadillo has become a well-known artist in many corners of the world, and chances are that you have seen his artwork around town. When people take a close look at his art, they're often impressed at the incredible details they find.
My dream as a child was to be a commercial artist.
And that dream definitely came true. Robert Delgadillo, professionally known as Rad, has become one of the most acclaimed commercial artists in Hollywood.
My artwork is about energy, it's about youth, it's about glamour, it's about beauty, it's about Hollywood. It's a fusion of all these different things, and it's a celebration of life.
But Rad's art is not purely about making people smile, it's about making profit. His illustrations have been featured in multi-million dollar advertising campaigns.
For several years I did, I illustrated pieces for Kitson and helped them establish the brand that they are today. So, you know, whether it was in a Nordstrom or in one of the Kitson boutiques or just around town, you could see my art on billboards or in magazines.
I decided to ask Rad what the best part of being a celebrity artist is.
For me as an artist, it's actually getting to interact with a lot of the celebrities that I based my work on. And as of the date, it's always been positive responses. It's great to see them smile and see them recognize themselves as they're looking at the artwork. That for me has been it's the most exciting part of it all.
Hollywood, the Walk of Fame, stars, celebrities, paparazzi are the driving force behind celebrity artist Rad's work. But the road to success wasn't always easy.
I have to say it was well worth every minute of it.
Despite the struggles to make it in this competitive industry, Rad has managed to make a name for himself.
My newest collection is a series inspired by Marilyn Monroe. Definitely this has been my most ambitious collection by far to date in terms of the amount of work and the energy and the time I've put into this. You can actually see in this series the transformation of Norma Jean into the ultimate movie star.
I asked Rad who might be next to appear in his work. He left me eager to see what's on the horizon.
I never know what's gonna inspire me next. I mean, it can be someone as iconic as Frank Sinatra, you know, Dean Martin and Sammy Davis Jr., or somebody very contemporary like Lady Gaga.
As Rad says, the best is yet to come, and all we can do
is wait. In Hollywood, I'm Rigo Villalobos for Valley View News.
Red is currently working on a coffee table book where he will include what he considers his best pieces, and some he has never shown before.
Here's the scoop.
Now Vanessa Soto has the latest on the new X Factor judges and more. Take it away, Vanessa.
Season 2 of The X Factor premiered with new celebrity judges and with few great talent performances. Britney Spears and Demi Lovato were the new judges. Spears gave harsh criticism, but Lovato was nicer to the performers. With four judges that have different personalities, it is uncertain what kind of season the show will have. American Idol fans can look forward to two new judges this season. Nicki Minaj and country musician Keith Urban are going to be joining the Idol panel. The two music stars are joining Mariah Carey and veteran Idol judge Randy Jackson. Idol producers hope the new additions will help the show remain the number one singing competition ahead of The X Factor and The Voice. Amanda Bynes has been cited for driving with a suspended license. The celebrity's BMW was impounded in Burbank over the weekend. Her license was suspended because of two alleged hit-and-run incidents and an alleged driving under the influence arrest. Bynes is due in court September 21st and 27th on the three charges. After a slow showing, the box office got back on track. Paul Anderson's Resident Evil Retribution took the top spot. The action thriller earned more than $20 million in ticket sales. A well-known family favorite, Finding Nemo 3D, took the second spot. The Disney animation took in more than $17 million, rounding up the top three in the last week's The Possession. The horror film made more than $6 million at the box office. A French court will rule on whether to block further publication of topless photos of Kate Middleton. The gossip magazine Closer has published 14 photos of Middleton, and the Italian magazine Kai has published the 26-page spread. The Duchess of Cambridge was relaxing at a private villa in southern France when a photographer took the pictures. Justice Minister Alan Shatter says sections of the print media believe that public figures have no privacy. That's it for entertainment. Back to you.
Not only are the waistlines of Americans expanding, but so are our pets. 53% of dogs were classified as overweight or obese by their veterinarians. Valley View News reporter Lauren Ari has the story on how these dogs are swimming into shape.
Meet Diesel. Diesel's a four-year-old Rottweiler mix who swims for 30 minutes each week at the Total Dog Gym in Oceanside. Weight loss and ACL repair are the reasons behind his weekly visits. Diesel was adopted 2 years ago by Katie Avery and her husband after he was found abandoned at a lake in Chula Vista.
We were basically first-time dog owners. We didn't have a clue pretty much at all what we should be feeding the dogs. And since he was kind of basically abandoned, who knows how long he had eaten for, he just ate everything in sight.
Diesel was initially 98 pounds when the Averys adopted him, but his weight would soon balloon to up to 120 pounds.
We didn't really think much of it. Like I said, it was our first dog. We were like, hey, you know, he's getting kind of fat, but maybe that's just how he is. He's a big dog.
The Averys are not alone. The Association for Pet Obesity Prevention found that the central part of the problem is more owners are unaware their pets are overweight. In fact, the study found that 22% of dog owners characterized their pets as normal weight when the dogs were actually overweight or obese. Weekly swims at the Total Dog Gym and a change in diet has helped Diesel shed 10 pounds.
So we hope to get him down to about 100 or a little bit under, and definitely continuing to swim and do that will get him there.
The Total Dog Gym offers a wide variety of activities, which includes a lap pool, therapy spa, underwater treadmill, and exercise room. Even if your dog does not have its own gym membership, there are alternative ways to keep your dog in shape. Veterinarians recommend dogs to exercise for 30 minutes each day and to replace kibble with canned food or home-cooked meals. In the end, it is key to make living a healthy lifestyle top priority for all members of the family, including our pets. Oh, I'm just talking. After all, what's better than living a long, healthy life with your best friend? In Northridge, Lauren Ari, Valley View News.
Coming up, find out if where university students sit in class can affect their grade.
For pregnant women, the threat of this year's flu season is very real. If you're expecting a baby, you're at higher risk of serious flu-related complications. That's why the CDC recommends pregnant women take simple steps to protect themselves and their babies. Cough or sneeze into your sleeve or a tissue. Get both the H1N1 and seasonal flu vaccines. Avoid contact with anyone who is sick, and if you do get sick, stay home and seek treatment immediately. For more information, go to flu.gov.
Turning a 20-foot wall into a canvas takes vision. So we're getting into college. I've got what it takes. So do you.
Good afternoon, Mrs. Williams. What do you have for me this time?
My husband and my son.
That will do nicely. What will you bring me next time?
Life.
It never ceases to amaze me what people will give up for a drink.
I've seen and been a part of many comebacks in my career.
To come back and win, you can't lose hope.
Take it one play at a time.
Grab every opportunity.
And when you can,
you make a big play.
There are over 13 million people in the Horn of Africa affected by famine, war, and drought that are counting on us for help.
As a team, we can help end this crisis.
Text GIVE to 777-444 to donate $10.
Let's start this comeback together.
Together.
The Arizona Cardinals did something no other team has done against the Patriots, and the number two ranked college football team fell. Daniel Magallon has more.
Thank you very much. The New England Patriots were looking to extend their home opener winning streak. They've won them all since they moved into Gillette Stadium in 2002. But the Arizona Cardinals had another thing in mind. With the Patriots leading in the third quarter, Kevin Cole passes to Andre Roberts for the touchdown. Then with only a minute into the fourth, Cole runs for a 5-yard score, taking the lead to 20-9 after a 53-yard field goal. Patriots then try to pick it up with Brady throwing a 12-yard TD to Rob Gronkowski. The Patriots' future started to look up when the pitch to Ryan Williams fumbles onto the Cardinals' 30-yard line. But with 1 second to go, Steven Gronkowski sends his kick to the left. Arizona clinches the victory and stops a 10-year-long home opener winning streak, a shocker for the Pats. In college football, the number two ranked USC Trojans went up to Palo Alto to take on the Stanford Cardinal. We pick it up late in the third. Josh Nunez connects with running back Stephon Taylor. A little bit of spice and flavor, a little bit of dancing, and look at my dust, and Taylor was in the end zone. Stanford ties it at 14 early in the fourth. Nunez steps back, surveys the field, and fires a dart to Zach Ertz, who sidesteps into the end zone. Stanford upsets USC 21-24. We now head to the Rose Bowl. Second play of the game, a lateral pass is picked up by the UCLA defense. Eric Kendricks takes it back to put the first 6 points up on the scoreboard. With the Bruins up 17-0, quarterback Brett Hundley hits Jordan James for a 12-yard touchdown to give the Bruins a 24-point lead. The Bruins defeated the Cougars 37-6. The Bruins will now face Oregon State in the Pac-12 opener for both teams. In Major League Baseball, the Dodgers went into the game tied with the St. Louis Cardinals for the last wild card spot. We head to the bottom of the third. With a runner on third, Andre Ether connects with the golf swing and sends the ball into the right field pavilion. In extra innings, with the bases loaded, Cardinals' Alan Craig comes up with a big hit in the middle to make the ball game 4-2. The Cardinals tacked on another run to make it 5-2, came away with a one-game lead. In Kansas City, the Angels were looking to gain ground in the American League wildcard race. We go to the first inning with a runner on second. Torii Hunter connects to score Eric Ibar. Angels up 1-0. Top of the second with two runners on, Mark Trumbo sends one into orbit. Well, almost. It goes back, and it clears the center field wall to make it 4-0. The Royals tacked on three runs to make it 4-3. Despite the win, the Angels remain 2.5 games behind Baltimore in the wild card race. Here at Cal State Northridge, the men's soccer team made its home debut with a 5-0 beatdown against the Army Black Knights. 2 days later, the Matadors returned to the pitch to score a 2-1 victory over Temple University. The wins over the weekend gave them a record of 4 wins and 3 losses. The women's volleyball team did not drop a set on its way to the Rice Invitational Crown. CSUN will now head into conference play with a record of 9-3. They will host 8th-ranked Hawaii to begin their Big West schedule. And that's it for sports. Now back to you guys.
Apple's iPhone 5 has hit record high sales with more than 2 million orders. The number doubled the Apple record set last year with the iPhone S. The company says the demand has exceeded the supply, and many of those who ordered may not see their new iPhone until October. iPhone carrier AT&T says it has taken record orders for the iPhone 5.
Does where you sit in class influence your grades? Valley View News reporter Tasneen Hanafi has more on a study that tries to explain if grades are affected by where you sit.
These students walking to class might be thinking where they'll be sitting when they go to their next classroom. A recent study has found that the key to getting good grades is all about location, location, location. Dr. David Rosengrant from Kennesaw State University conducted the study on students in a lecture hall. Using portable eye-tracking devices, Rosengrant was able to follow student gaze patterns. The result? Students who sat in the front and middle are more likely to pay attention during class. People who sat in the back didn't always perform worse, but were prone to get distracted more easily.
So is Dr. Rosengrant's study true in all classroom settings? I went around campus to get a student's perspective.
I like sitting in the back because sometimes I like to do other things while in class, I'll admit that. But also, like, I just prefer sitting in the back. I feel like it's less distracting. You can kind of see around, see who's participating, do other things.
I like sitting in the front and I can focus and I can learn better. It's like my main focus is the professor. I have nothing else going on.
In the middle?
Why?
I don't know, because if I sit in the back, I know I'll get distracted in the front. I don't know, I just feel too close to the professor.
But whether you sit in the front, middle, or back, many professors say they'll call you to participate anyway. CSUN educational psychology professor Ellen Stoll says she tries to learn all of her students' names and calls on them frequently.
I have to consistently call the names of students in the back to engage them in the conversation, make sure that I'm keeping an eye on them and that my line of sight is seeing everybody and including everybody.
The next time students go to class, they might think twice about where they want to sit if they want a good grade. In Northridge, Tasneem Hanafi, Valley View News.
Professor Stoll says this study is a small part in analyzing why students sit where they do, and that more studies in the type of person that sits in the back, middle, and front should be conducted.
Thanks for tuning in to Valley View News. I'm Dennis Rue.
And I'm Emily Davies. Have a great week.